Now in recursion also we use stack. We'll see. So who uses that stack? So in a program, however, you know, we are not using stack, right? But who uses this stack, you know, and where we use it, we'll see. So whenever you write a high level program, what happens is this high level program is converted to low level program by your compiler. Okay, that's why let me imagine that there is one compiler and there is a machine. So finally, this machine should understand these instructions, however it cannot understand, that's why. So this compiler is going to convert all these instructions to machine level instructions. Okay, so that machine level instructions, so that your machine can execute them. That is what the idea. But that machine level instructions should be such a way that, you know, this program should be evaluated. Now let's think about a small program. Let's say there is a main program and that there is instruction C equal to A plus B. Even for this small line, so to convert it into, you know, machine level, there we need lot of instructions. So actually what your machine does, you should understand. Your machine can do, let's say, assume that it can understand only these things. It can load into some register some memory location value. This is one thing. Okay, we are trying to understand that in a easier way. That means we are not going into details because it is not a computer organization class, right? So that's why I would like to just give rough understanding. That's it. Okay, try to understand in high level. Second one, add R1, R2. That means your computer can understand, I mean, add two registers, this kind of things. So using this kind of instructions, this program has to be evaluated. For that, what your compiler do is, so that compiler converts this high level program to suitable instructions like this. I can say that this kind of instructions are, of course, machine level instructions. So only your computer can understand this. Then, so C equal to A plus B can be converted like this. First of all, this is main memory. Somewhere, you know, there will be a variable C, there will be memory for variable C, and there will be a variable memory for variable A, there will be memory for variable B. Okay, your compiler will take care of that while executing. So while, you know, compiling, first of all it will compile, after that it will generate a machine code. So that machine code, you know, finally maps every variable to some memory location like this somewhere. After that, now what are the other things we should do? We have to add A plus B. So what happens, first of all, this is A, this is B, but no machine can add memory location values directly. So your machine is designed such a way that it will have an adder circuit, let's say, that can generally add registers R1, R2. Then what we do is we store A value into R1, B value into R2, then we do adding, correct? So that's why suitable instruction for this entire code is first load R1, what value? Memory location of, example, this is 100. Okay, this is 200, this is 300. Then memory at 200 should be loaded to R1. So this kind of code will be generated by whom? Compiler. That's why you don't know it. Okay, then second one, load R2 into R2, what? Memory location of 300. If all these things are done, then only your real program will be executed. What else to be done? Just try to guess. We have now values R1, R2 into registers. Then if we connect that registers R1, R2 to adder circuit, then addition will be done. Let me do that. Add R1, R2. So here my assumption is whenever I do add R1, R2, R1 and R2 are added, and result is, let's say, stored back in R1. That means you are getting result in R1. Understand? Otherwise there will be some machines where there will be instructions like add R3, R1, R2. Okay, this kind of things we'll see in, you know, compilers and computer organization. Okay, now let me assume that there is an instruction like add R3, R1, R2 if you want, so that we can clearly understand. This is another register R3. Then when we execute this add R3, R1, R2, automatically R1, R2 have that values, right? A value, B value, they will be added and they will be stored back to R3. Now we have answer in R3. Correct? Then you tell me how to store it in C. For that, what is the machine instruction? There is an instruction called store that will store register value into memory location. Okay, what is source? Source is register 3. What is destination? Memory location of 300. Your compiler knows where is, sorry, it is 100, right? Memory location of 100. So your compiler knows where is C, where is A, where is B. While compilation time, your compiler itself stores the values into this particular memory locations and it remembers them through symbol table. That's why if you go into details, then you know you will get lot of details. That's why I don't want to go into depth. Okay, so because it's a data structures class, we try to understand the basic idea, what is happening. Okay, so finally when you write a machine level, I mean high level program, that will be converted to this kind of low level machine instructions, and I can say that this is the memory your computer uses, correct? Otherwise your compiler uses. These are the memory locations. So sir, I am not seeing any stack. Yes, you are not seeing any stack here, but after all you have written one instruction. Now see the situation. If there is a function called something like f, okay, and that function contains, let's say roughly I write what is that function. That function contains three memory variables x, y, z, okay, integers. Then actually according to high level, forget about low level, in high level what should happen after this execution, your control should go to f, and you know this variable should be created and some activity should be done and we should come back. All these things should happen. For that again, see, after all because of this line, your compiler has to create three memory locations, right? Your compiler has to do. Then because of this function, again in main memory, I can say, again your compiler has to create three variables x, y, z somewhere, and it has to load the values. Maybe if x has value, y has value, z has value, it should be loaded, and after that computation should be evaluated. For that again corresponding machine instruction should be generated. Your compiler can do it, but forget about the how it is generating the machine instructions. I want to focus on memory part, like how your compiler is maintaining the memory. So when you are executing here, I can say that this is environment. When you are in main environment, your compiler has to remember these three memory locations, that is sufficient. When we go to different environment, that is F, then your compiler has to remember some other memory locations. Once this function is closed, go back to scope rules and lifetime, then this variable x, variable y, variable z need not to have memory, correct? That means you can deallocate the memory of x, y, z. Compiler can deallocate this memory x, y, z, and it has to do that. Why? For efficiency. Okay, then what I want to say is finally your compiler has to remember the environment here through CAB, and when we reach F, then X, Y, Z. After that, when we come back, this memory should be deallocated by your compiler. Then your compiler is said to be efficient compiler, correct? So for that, how to design a system of memory so that we can do these things very effectively? That is what the concept of, you know, application of stack. That means in this class we are going to learn how your compiler uses that stack effectively to maintain the environment. Okay, so we'll see that with a bigger program. Okay, now you understand the rough idea about, you know, and the need of the stack. Why stack is required, I will tell you. So to maintain this environment, just understand this environment, I will show pictorially. Here you see example, let's say when you are in main program, you have to remember the environment CAB, correct? After that, so you, when you go to function F, then we have to remember XYZ memory locations, isn't it? Yes. After that, we have to remember something else. If from F, if we go to G, then you have to remember some other variables KLM. When we come back from G, then this KLM should be removed, correct? Understand? That means what are the recent, what is the recent environment G? When you come out from the recent environment G, then all that memory locations should be removed from the total memory, correct? So this behavior is nothing but stack behavior. That's why we use stack to implement memory management of any C program. Okay, so now summary. The summary is very simple. You write high level program and your compiler converts into low level program, and your compiler is going to maintain all your variables through some memory, correct? So in main memory, your compiler maintains them. How it maintains, what is the data structure it uses, is stack. So how your compiler uses that stack structure, we'll see now.